Hi, welcome back to The Rustic Wife. I'm Alana. I'm just in my hen house. It's so windy, so I thought I'd just jump in here and start my video, I guess, in the hen house. My daughter's inside doing online schooling, so I wanted to come outside and shoot some footage. Today's topic, I wanted to talk about starting a garden, and there are a few things you should consider when starting a garden, and I'm going to go over those tips for you. Well, the tips that I use that have worked for us anyway, so I will get right to them. The first tip that I want to talk to you about is knowing your plant hardiness zone. Now, a plant hardiness zone, or growing zone as some people call it, so those zones are designed to tell you roughly when your last frost date is and when your first frost date is going to be. So between those two time periods, that is going to tell you, depending on what zone you're in, how long of a growing season you're going to have. So for instance, I am in zone 5B and I know my last frost date is usually around May 24th. But you really have to watch the weather for that. That's just a guideline. And my last frost date is generally the last week of September, sometimes the first week of October. So I know I have that long of a growing season, so about 4 months. So I have to watch what I grow. I can't grow a peach tree here. I mean, I could grow a peach tree here, but I just don't have the optimal temperature and length of growing season. So those are things to consider as to when you're going to plant. And it'll also determine whether you start your seeds indoors or direct seed. So for instance, we start tomato seeds, pepper seeds, onions, leeks, some other certain flowers. Hi, Lulu. Certain flowers, we have to start those indoors, because if you look at the back of your seed packet, it gives you all the information that you really need. Well, most of the information that you really need. It'll tell you when to start sowing it indoors, the soil temperature that you'll need to start your seeds. It'll tell you how deep to plant them, row spacing in between each plant spacing. It tells you a lot of information. Also, if you're buying fruit trees, they'll be tagged best for, say, zones 5 to 9 or something like that. So then you can, hi Otis, then you know, right? Hi babe. Then you know what you can plant in your growing season. No, don't bite that. Jeez, he's biting the microphone. Why, Otis, why? I don't even know what I said because he was biting the microphone. Oh gosh. Anyway, as I mentioned before about weather and the guidelines for your first and last frost date, or your last and first frost date, really pay attention to the weather, because just because it says your last frost date is May 24th, doesn't mean you should go out and plant May 24th. Watch your weather, because you would hate to go to the trouble of growing all of your seedlings, planting them at your alleged last frost date, and getting them zapped by a late frost. Number two, figure out what you're going to plant according to your growing zone, and try to direct seed as much as you can. You wouldn't want to start, say, radishes indoors. There's a growing season or a growing time for a radish that's like 25 days long. So you wouldn't want to take up space inside starting radish seeds inside to transplant them. You want to disrupt the roots as little as possible. So whatever you can direct seed, and whatever you need to start indoors, then you start indoors. Oh, it has stopped. You're crazy. When you're planning your garden site, make sure it's in an area where there's at least 6 hours of direct sunlight. You'll see over my shoulder here, I've got some roses. This south side of the house is a perfect place for my roses. They absolutely thrived. So it's the same with your vegetable patch. You want to make sure it's not all completely shaded. Some things do well in a bit of shade, but most things need at least 6 hours of direct sunlight. Another tip is to know what kind of soil you are working with. If you have really, really crappy soil with poor drainage and it's like concrete, you're just going to set yourself up for some frustration later on down the road, and you might even say forget it. So beforehand, just do yourself a favor and make sure you've got some good soil. If you don't have any, you can amend it. That's not a quick fix, but you can add compost, organic matter. We invested in 20 yards of triple mix. We had that brought in and put on top of our garden because we have clay and it's really tough to work with. So we did that. In the fall, you can do things like plant cover crop. That adds some nice green manure, as they call it, to your soil, and that adds a lot of nutrients and things back into the soil. So I'm not a real professional composter. I usually just toss everything into a pile and hope for the best. But I am going to show you the difference between our crappy soil and some of the stuff that has been composted. This is our old pig pen. We're not using it this year. But see, we just kind of put everything into a pile. And this is my kitchen scrap garden waste pile. We've got corn stalks on there. It's not the correct way of doing it, but I don't have one of those compost bins or anything like that, so this is what I do. But I am going to show you what's underneath this big mess. So you can see I just took the pitchfork and I moved the top layer off. And underneath here, it started to break down, and we've got some nice organic matter there. So that will add a lot of nutrients, but we're going to just keep letting that break down some more. By my hen house here. And a while back, I actually just used to just toss the pine shavings and the chicken manure back here before the wood pile was here. And the chickens scratch it all up. And then there's lots of maple leaves that land on top of it for compost. But look at this soil. So that's some accidental composting. And that is so beautiful. Full of nutrients. Just perfect. So that's what composting does for you, even though it's accidental. Hi, Chester. A good idea to get your soil tested too. You can take it to a sample of your garden soil to the Ministry of Agriculture and Rural Affairs. You may have a building or a department in your area. And they'll just check for the pH and nutrient levels in your soil. So you can always start there and know where you have to go after that. So this is one of my gardens up front. It actually looks like the moon. So you can see some things are just starting to come up. I've got some perennials here, but the soil is not great. So this is one of the gardens that we're going to have to amend and or get some soil brought in. But it is clay. It's really hard to weed. And it's tough for plants to grow in. And oh, just get out of here. Yeah. When you're planting your garden, consider companion planting. Do a little bit of research as to what plants like to be planted beside each other or near each other and which ones don't. If you plant ones that don't like to be together, nothing really bad's going to happen. You just may not get maximum crop production, that's all. Companion planting does offer a lot of benefits, such as it can help with insect control, it can help with pollination, maximizes space too, and it's another one. It also offers habitat for the beneficial bugs that'll help eat all of your bad bugs, I guess. So do a little bit of research for that. Years ago when I used to plant my garden, I just used to just toss everything in there, but it really does make a difference. It helps. Also, don't overcrowd your space. Just know how much space you have. If you don't have a lot of room, then you can always do some container gardening. You can put up some trellises for some climbers like cucumbers or pole beans, peas, things like that. You can do a tiered raised beds, but if you do have a bit of space that you can make quite a bit of a large garden, just don't overcrowd everything. I've done that lots of times, and my husband will always tell me that the specs on the back of the seed package, they're there for a reason. If you overcrowd everything, it looks okay when you first plant it, but when everything becomes mature, it's just a jungle. It's just really hard to weed in there too. It just becomes an absolute jungle. So another one you can consider too is to succession plant. That means to just plant a little bit each week until your row is filled, and that will give you a little bit of breathing room when it comes to harvesting. A couple of good ones to do that with is lettuce, green beans. They all come on at once, and you can only eat so much salad and so many green beans before you're sick of them. So succession planting is another good idea. Knowing how much to plant, that's another big one. I get asked that a lot, and that really depends on what you're going to do with your vegetables. Are you just going to do fresh eating for you and your family? Are you going to try to sell it at a farmer's market? Are you going to try to preserve it for the year for your family? So there's a few things to consider, and there's a lot of resources online. Johnny Seeds, that's a company in Maine, in the United States, they have a pretty good website, and I'll leave a link below. It's the average crop yield for transplanted vegetables or direct seed vegetables. So you can just go look up if you're going to plant beans, cucumbers, corn, whatever. They've got the average crop yield for those. And if you're planning on canning and you need to know how much to plant, Jessica from Three Rivers Homestead has done a really good YouTube video, and she talks about planning for the entire year for her family of nine. So I'll leave a link below for her YouTube channel as well. And she's got a formula that she has, and she goes through to figure out how many quart jars she's going to need for her entire family, but how much she's going to have to grow to fill all those quart jars for her entire family for the entire year. So I'll leave a link below for that video as well. When there's my dog, Chief. So I tried to make this video as painless as possible. It's kind of a dry topic. It's necessary, but it is kind of dry. So those are a few tips that you can consider when you're going to start your garden, and hope they can help you. So if you like the content of my channel, please consider subscribing, like this video, and I will see you next time.